Hi everybody, welcome back to the lecture Computer Animation, today about motion capture and tracking and option detection. My name is Gerald Schuller. Yeah, first motion capture. So this is the capture of complex natural motion sequences, and the objectives here are realistic animations and saving time and money by capturing it. The technical implementations or realizations are mechanical systems, then magnetic systems, acoustic systems, and finally optical systems, which can be active or passive. And there are further applications in biomechanics, sports, science, and so on. And variants of it are match moving, motion tracking, and object tracking, to which we come later. So first, the advantages of motion capture are a fast creation of complex animations. So you can imagine you have an actor and he moves in a certain way, and basically you copy his movements. And you get a more detailed animation, and thus it's more realistic. The disadvantages is you need sophisticated equipment, like when you have this actor, you need to have a system to capture his precise movement. And the post-processing of the animations is often difficult, for instance, if you have errors in it. And also, only real possible movements can be recorded, which is a disadvantage if you have like fantasy movies where you have some fantasy beings. So here you're restricted by what can be done by, for instance, humans. Yeah, so in motion capture, recordable parameters are the position, the angle between object parts, the speed, and the acceleration. And important system parameters are the local resolution that you get, then the acquisition volume, and the sampling rate, so how often you sample the data. Yeah, so you have mechanical systems. So for instance, in an actor, you have certain sensors which you then attach to, for instance, the arm and the legs, and they measure the angles and such. So here you have the acquisition via angle sensors, bending sensors, for instance, a data glove. You also have a low freedom of movement because those sensors can obstruct the movement. And there's also little flexibility in the application. Then you have magnetic system. So there you have less friction. Here you have the detection via magnetic sensors. But you have a low local resolution power. So it should be resolution. Resolution. And you don't really need the power here. And you also have low sampling rate in these systems. And it reacts sensitively to disturbances like magnetic fields. Right. When you have magnetic fields from some other place, then this might disturb it. You have applications mainly in virtual reality, for instance, the virtual joystick. Yeah, then you have acoustic systems. Here you have a transmitter that generates ultrasonic pulses and microphones in the studio that detect the pulses, so basically like sonar. And then you have the calculation of the distance from the runtime, yeah, I would say from from the source of the sound. The disadvantage here is there must be nothing between the transmitter and the microphone. Here you can see an example, so it's actually kind of bulky. So I should call this sound source. Yeah, so this is the example Nintendo Power Glove. So it's maybe a little bit bulky. Yeah, then we have here this example. So here we have this actor here, and then you have a virtual avatar, which is having the same posture. Here you can see motion capture using mechanics. So here this is actually kind of an exoskeleton, which has those angle sensors. Yeah, so now to optical systems. The capture marked objects with multiple cameras. Say let's detect object with multiple cameras. We have an active system which uses reflective self-luminous coated markers, so little LED lamps for instance, and passive, which is basically reflections, so you have reflective markings for instance. And in development we have markerless systems via correspondence point search. So here you would just have a camera and it looks for points in consecutive frames and tries to estimate the movement. Basically like in video coding. Yeah, then you have the calculation of the position of the markers by triangulation. Right, so especially when you have multiple cameras, then each position has a different angle to the different cameras, and these angles are used by triangulation to compute the position in space. You know, or you could also use a known size, like if you know a person's head has a certain size, then if this head is appearing smaller, then you know that it must be further away, and this is also a way to estimate the position. Yeah, then you have the binding of markers to a virtual skeleton. So these markers are at a known point at this virtual skeleton, and thereby we know boundary conditions and we can calculate joint angles. Yeah, this gives us a high local resolution, perhaps even submillimeter, high sampling rates depending on the cameras used, and large measuring volume, basically everything the cameras can capture. Yeah, and this requires an interpolation for temporally invisible markers. So here's an example. Here we have points which are lighting up. Could be little LEDs, could be also reflective markers. And these points are then used to estimate the position and angles of the joints and the position of the skeleton. Yeah, so this leads us to mesh moving and motion tracking. Mesh moving is the insertion of a virtual object instead of a real object in a normal captured scene without special technology as in motion capture, with correct position, scale, orientation, and speed. So the goal here is to determine extrinsic and intrinsic camera parameters from the camera image. Right. So the extrinsic parameters are the position, X, Y, and Z, and the position, pan, tilt, and roll. And the intrinsic parameters are the focal length and the focus. Right. So this is basically given by the camera. The problem is usually underdetermined, and that means we need to introduce certain boundary conditions. Yeah, so this is the mode of operation. We set markers or features in our scene. We track these markers in the image sequence. Then we have the definition of further boundary conditions, like the distance between features, the distance between camera and features, and the location of multiple features in one layer. And then we can determine the projection matrix of our virtual camera. And we can use reprojection and refinement. So in this way, we can put a real object into a virtual scene. Yeah, the prerequisites are suitable markings in the image and a direct determination of as many boundary conditions as possible. Yeah, so actually we need to know the projection matrix of both the real and virtual camera so that we have a good fit of the objects. Yeah, so this means we set as many boundary conditions as possible using a constant focal length, so no zooming, constant position, no camera movement, pan tilt roll around the projection center, and note all known parameters like focal length, camera height and position, distance of the camera to certain features, distance of the features amongst themselves. And in our real scenery, we use a tripod. If there's little texture, introduce artificial markers and move the camera parallel to the image plane to get additional information through parallel and avoid motion blur. So these are all things that makes this approach easier. Yeah. Yeah, so here's an example. So we have a real scene and then we try to create a virtual object out of this real scene to place it into a virtual scene. Yeah, this leads us then to object tracking. This is the determination of position, location and movement of objects from an image sequence. And in two dimension, this is corner pinning. So basically we need to follow the corners. For instance, to exchange a TV picture in a recording. In three dimensions, it would be the determination of spatial information, for instance, to retexture more complex objects. And it's often part of compositing software. Yeah, so here you can see the object tracking. So here you recognize those cubes on a table, and here we can see the markings to the corners of those cubes. And then we could, for instance, replace those real cubes by virtual cubes. Yeah, and this leads us to the object detection. This is an object recognition through features. And important features are edges, alignments of edges. There's a quotation mark missing here. Yeah, so edges are important features because they're actually easy to detect. And edge detection or highlighting is when we distribute small masks which are matched to the edges over the image. According to the mask, a weighted sum is formed for each resulting pixel, which then results in the result image. And an example of a mask that can detect edges of any orientation is this matrix here. So basically, this leads us back to signal processing, where we have an image or a virtual scene. Well, let's start with the camera image as just a matrix of pixel values. And if we now use this mask as a filter kernel, then this resulting filtered image will be highlighted at edges. Right. So we just take this camera image, convolve it with this filter kernel, and out comes edges which have higher pixel values and even spaces which have low pixel values. Right. So the result pixel y of n comma m, so this is again the coordinates in this resulting image, vertically, horizontally, is then obtained from the input image x by the weighted sum over the neighborhood of the input pixels x of n comma m. Right, this weighted sum is the convolution. Here you can see it. Here you have the two-dimensional convolution. You can actually recognize it by the sum indices going down in the first factor and going up in the second factor. Right, so here you can see the image, the original image X, and here we have our mask, the filter kernel M. And here again is our filter kernel, and this is how we get our result image. And when you look now at this mask M, and imagine your original X is just a surface with no edges, which means all the pixels have equal value, then basically you have a constant times the M, and you sum over all the M. So basically you would have a constant times the sum over all entries of M. And when you look at it, we have 8 minus 1s and then a plus 8. That means they add up to 1, to 0, right? So the sum becomes 0. So that means if you have no edges, then the output Y will be 0. Right, so only in case of imbalances, like an edge, through the region of where we have this M, the sum gets a non-zero value. I should say value instead of amount. Some things are lost in translation here. Yeah. So if you calculate the sum for the whole image, it is identical with the two-dimensional convolution, and we write simplified y equals x convolved with m. And the matrix M is therefore also called a filter impulse response, or a filter kernel. Right? And we can actually have different filter kernels. This is now a filter kernel for detecting horizontal edges. So again, you can see all the entries again sum up to zero, such that if we have just a plane, then the output will be zero. But if we have a horizontal edge, like high values down here, low values up here, it's not balanced anymore, and we get a pixel which has a higher output. Right. Yeah, so we get a higher magnitude. So also observe that this magnitude, that this value can be zero, minus a negative, right? So it can be positive and negative depending also on how the edge looks like. If we have a vertical edge, then we can see again all these entries would cancel to a zero, right? As long as all the vertical entries have the same factor, they add up to zero. So this only detects horizontal edges. So we see if the image intensity does not change vertically, right? Only if it changes vertically, we get a non-zero output. The resulting convolution sum is zero, right? If vertically we have the same value, then the output will be zero. Only in case of vertical change, which means horizontal edges, the amount or the magnitude of the sum becomes non-zero. Well, let's call this the magnitude. Yeah, so this is actually these are good filters. So we have the first filter kernel for any edge, and this only detects horizontal edges. Similar for vertical edges. For vertical edges, we just transpose this filter kernel, and now we have this shape here. So this only detects vertical edges where we have changes horizontally. So we see if the image intensity does not change horizontally, the resulting convolution sum is zero. Only in case of vertical change, which means vertical edges, the amount of the sum becomes non-zero. So here I would say the same. I would call this the magnitude. Yeah, so now we also have this vertical edge detector. So this can now be used for detecting objects. So like this cube. A cube consists of horizontal and vertical edges and also diagonal edges. So we can use those three edge detectors And then we can see where those edges are, and from that information we can conclude if it's a cube or not. So here I have a little Python example. In Python there's the library scipy signal. So this contains the convolution function convolve2D. So very practical, because that's exactly what we need here for images. With this we can easily try out the edge detection. For example, we define our filter for arbitrary edges with filled equals, now we define a matrix here. So here's the first row of this matrix, here's the second row, and here's the last row. And we can see this is this arbitrary edge detector, right? We have minus ones and only the 8 in the middle. Then we can execute the convolution with yfilled equals scipy signal convolve2D. We apply it to the image y, right? Y is our input here. Then we convolve it with filled, our filter kernel. And mode here is set to same, where same indicates that the output yfilled is the same size as the input y. So when you have a convolution, actually mathematically, the output is larger than the input. So basically, the output is the sum of the input, the sum of the sizes of the two convolution signals, minus one. But here we want to have y the same, so that's why the mode equals same helps us to basically cut off the additional edge values. So we then loop this for each frame or frame of our video and display the amount or the magnitude. Of my field. So somehow the translator translated magnitude wrongly. Yeah, and we can do this with example video content disp.py. So let me now open it, copy, control C, go to my terminal shell, and say gedit, open it in an editor to see what's in it. And here we can see the content. So here we can see it first starts with importing the necessary libraries, scipy signal, CV2 for camera capture. Here we start accessing the camera, camera 0, and cap is the capture object. And here we read one frame to see how large it is, right? And then we print the size. And here we can see our filter kernel, right? So here we have this matrix of our generic kernel. If you want, we can also divide it by a normalization factor here, which I didn't really use. Here I have as an alternative the matrix for horizontal edges, here for vertical edges, and then I also have a low pass kernel, basically, which is doing a running average over the neighborhood, so this blurs an image. Yeah, and here you can see our real-time while loop, while true. So this is an infinite loop. It reads from the camera. It computes the y component, the luminance, as this weighted average of the primary colors, normalized and divided by 256, such that the output is between 0 and 1. Then here we do the filtering with convolve2D. The result is in yfilled. And we take the magnitude of yfilled. Remember, the result of this convolution can have negative values, which we cannot really represent and are really not so interesting for edge detection in our case. So that's why we just output a magnitude apps of yfilled using imshow. And we do it until I hit the key Q. Right, so Now again, I have my high resolution camera. Probably the image will be too large. Let's see. Let's test it. So here we have this general edge detector in it, Python 3. Let's see if that works. Yeah, so here you can see the size. It's indeed very big. And here you can see me in front of the camera plus edges in here on my wall. So that works. You have vertical edges, horizontal edges, diagonal edges at my head. So here you have all kinds of edges. So let me press the key Q. So now as an alternative, we can try the horizontal edge detector. So now I uncomment the horizontal edge detector and let's try it again. Yeah, very high resolution as you can see down here. And indeed, now you only see the horizontal edges, right? The vertical edges are gone. Just the horizontal edges. And somewhat the diagonal edges, right? So it still gets those diagonal edges, but not the vertical edges. So Q. And finally, try the vertical edges. Yeah, starts. And indeed, you can see now only the vertical edges are detected as high values, and those high values appear as bright lines or bright pixels here as the result. So here the vertical pixels and the vertical edges appear as bright pixels. The horizontal edges don't appear, as well as the background. Here the background, there are no edges, appears black, as well as the non-detected edges. So only the vertical edges appear as bright pixels. So this can then be conveniently used for object detection. Okay, so let me go back here for this generic edge detector. Yeah. So here we see that only edges in the image appear as bright stripes, otherwise the image is black as expected. And we saw the example of horizontal and vertical edges. If you change the filter to the matrices shown for horizontal and vertical edges respectively, only the correspondingly aligned edges appear as bright stripes. Right, that's what we just saw. With the appropriate combination of the differently oriented edges, we can now build object recognizers. Obtaining the suitable combination is usually done with the training on sample images. So usually we have training on those different filters. So you can imagine we have a system where we have different edge detectors, and then we have, for instance, a neural network which gets the outputs of those different edge detectors as input. And then we train this neural network on the object that we try to recognize. This is how the training would work. Yeah, so here's an example for a face recognizer, right? And this is basically working in this way. It uses different filters as input and then trains the system to recognize a face, actually a face and eyes. So we don't need to train it because CV2 conveniently also has a pre-trained face and eye recognizer. So this is convenient, but you can also train it yourself, but that takes some a lot of data to train it. A lot of examples. So here we can load the features for the recognizer using this command face cascade equals CV2 cascade classifier har cascade frontal face default.xml. So this is actually the recognizer, right? So these are the parameters of the system that recognizes the face. You can also load something else and then it will recognize something else. So here this cascade classifier is actually quite generic, and here you tell it what to recognize using the data. Yeah, then the pattern recognition happens with this function, phase cascade detect multiscale. So multiscale means that it detects at different sizes, right? So the phase can have different sizes on the image depending on how close to the camera it is. And it returns the coordinates and size of the found faces. So basically the position in the image or in the frame. These coordinates with a size can be used, for instance, to place squares around the found faces, right? So this returns the position and size. So that means we can also plot bounding boxes around the found faces. And since we also have a recognizer for the eyes, we can do the same for the eyes. So here's an example which does it. So again, let me first open it, copy, gedit.py. So here you can now see the content. So here we don't need the SciPy convolve, just CV2. And here it opens the HaarCascade frontal face default XML, the data for the face recognizer, and here HaarCascade eye.xml, the data for the eye recognizer. So here we have now two recognizer. Then we have the same video loop as before. Here we again turn it into a grayscale, this Y, the luminance value. Here we use the built-in converter instead of using the weighted average that we just did in the previous example. And here we do the detection, right? Here we have phase cascade detect multiscale. And here we have gray. This is the input from our camera. And here we have two parameters, 1.3 and 5, which I'm not sure what they mean. So this then returns the positions of the faces and the sizes. So here we can see what's inside with print, and we can see it's those four values. So it returns a list of four values for each face, right? So it's a list of lists basically, which outputs X, Y, the position in the image, and then width and height. And then we can use this data for each of the found faces to draw a rectangle at the position and with this width and height, using 255 would be this is the gray value, so this would be wide, and 2 would be the width of the wire of the rectangle. Then we do the same for the eyes. So for each eye, it also returns the X and Y coordinate and the width and the height. And we also draw a rectangle for each eye, same with the same type of boxes. Yeah, and then we show it here, the resulting grayscale image, until I hit the key Q. So let's see if that works on my high resolution image here, Python 3. Yes, so here you can see actually it draws this bounding box around my face, right? And also around my eyes. Sometimes it sees eyes in impossible places, so it shows it's not perfect, right? But it works more or less. Except I turn my head, I tilt my head. Yeah, then it's not recognizing my head anymore. It needs to have a straight head. So a tilted head doesn't work. Yeah, so it's only trained on straight heads, not on tilted heads. And also the eye detector is not really so great, as you can see here. So now you just need to know the expected size of a face and the camera parameters, and then you can estimate how far my face from the camera is, right? So then you have the position in space, then you have the position x and y, and you also have the distance z. Yeah, so facial recognition works indeed, and even in real time, kind of, right? We saw it was not very high rate, but still. Here you have the literature about this particular recognizer, rapid object detection using a boosted cascade of simple features. So these simple features are the edges that we just saw, right? And this is from the Conference on Computer Vision and Pattern Recognition in 2001. So it's actually quite some time ago, but it still works fine. So it's actually a very simple object detector, and that's also why it works so fast, right? Even on like embedded systems, it would work nicely, like on a Raspberry Pi, for instance. Yeah, here you can read more for this detector. So here is what happened there, tutorials. Yeah, so here's a link on how those detectors work and also how to train it. So if you want to train your own recognizer on different objects, say on cubes, if you want to recognize cubes, then you can do it using how they describe it here in the user guide. Right. So yeah, so now we can assume all faces are about the same size. The found size of a face in the image tells us how far away it is from the camera by means of the camera projection matrix. So the camera projection matrix gives us the connection to our world coordinates. The coordinates in the image give the position in space by means of the projection matrix. For the perspective projection, the x and y coordinates are divided by the z coordinate, right? When we have this perspective projection, remember we do this dividing by z because of the normalization of the homogeneous coordinates. That is actually what the homogeneous coordinates made so convenient, because it's so easy to do this projection. So again, we had that in slides 3a. We use the camera projection matrix of our virtual world to make our virtual object appear in place of the face in the real world, right? So now we have a camera image. We can compute the position in the real world, and then we can map this position into a virtual world where we have, for instance, a cube, and then we can replace the face by the cube in the same position. Or we could also use the head to control the position of the cube. So let's say we have the cube as an avatar of a face, and then we could control this cube in the virtual world by the face in front of the camera. Yeah, so as a result, the images of the real and virtual world look correspondingly only with different objects. Ly. So that means we have a mixed reality. Instead of using the mouse or keyboard, we position our virtual objects with the position of our face, for instance. Yeah, so here you can see it in more detail. So here is our projection matrix for the perspective projection. Right, so here we have our coordinates, world coordinates in our virtual world. Then we have our projection matrix, and here out comes the coordinates in the camera coordinate system. Right, this is the camera image coordinates. And since this is the homogeneous system, we just divide by the z coordinate, right? Because z here, w gets the z coordinates here, as you can see here. Yeah, so with an aspect ratio of 1 and f equals field, field of view as scaling, we get this simplified equation here. We have x equals f times xv, y equals f times yv, and w equals minus zv. Remember, this is the virtual world coordinates. And then we can back convert the homogeneous coordinates with w equals 1. So here we divide by the w and we get the coordinates in our camera. These are the camera coordinates, the non-homogeneous coordinates. Yeah, so here we now have the connection. We have the camera coordinates, the camera image, the frame coordinates, and the connection to the 3D world coordinates. So now we can infer the virtual coordinates from the image coordinates of the camera, right? So we take this equation here and solve it to xv, and we get this equation here. Same for yv. Want to go back to the virtual world coordinates, we get y times minus zv divided by f. And the virtual coordinate zv is obtained by taking a picture of an object of known size, here the head, with a known distance, right? Because our coordinate z is how far away we are from the camera. The smaller this object appears in the image coordinates, the further away it is, and the larger the magnitude of the zv coordinate becomes. So here's an example. We call our image or display coordinates xv and the virtual world coordinates xv, yv, and zv as before. We measure the height and the size of a head in image coordinates at a distance of the head of 1 meter from a camera, right? So basically we calibrate. So the head has a width of 16 centimeters, say, ear to ear. And the width of the head in image coordinates at 1 meter distance is w equals 150 pixels. Right? So that means we have 150 divided by 60 is 9.375 pixels per centimeter, or 937.5 pixels per meter. Right? So this gives us the correspondence between pixels and meters. This is true only for this distance, but we assume that in a certain environment we can use the same conversion without too much error. So also in different positions, we assume that we have good optics so that this actually holds anywhere in the image. We scale the virtual world coordinates so that 1 meter of the real world corresponds to a distance of 1 in the virtual world, right? Just for convenience. The smaller the display width w of the head, the larger is zv. So means when the head is further away, it appears smaller. So thus our estimation for the virtual world coordinates would be zv equals 150 divided by w, right? So here is this 150. Yeah, so now we can also calculate the other two coordinates. For the sake of simplicity, we assume f equals 1. So here we have xv and yv given our image coordinates x and y. So for the width of the head in virtual coordinates vw, for the width of the head in virtual coordinates, vw is obtained by this formula here. So we have vw is 150 divided by 937.5. Yeah. Okay. So I guess this should be WV. For the virtual world. Yeah, so now we have this W, which is the Z, the distance from the camera is 0.16 in the virtual world. So yeah, so we can now take our face detector, calculate the coordinates of the found heads and display them in the console. So here we have the face detector coordinate.py, and this detects the face as before, but now it also outputs the found coordinates, right? And here we should see that the coordinates appear plausible. The origins of the coordinates xv equals 0 and yv equals 0 appears in the center. Towards the top and to the right, the coordinates become larger and positive. So we should be able to see that. And also, if I move my head away, we should get a larger z coordinate. So let's try that. Copy and paste. Gedit. So let's first open the file to see what's inside. So here we have the same as before, our classifier detector. And here we have the infinite loop. And we have the for loop over the faces. And here we have the computation of the coordinates. So here the z-axis is 150 divided by the w, the width. Right, the width of the head, and here the y is, and the xy is here, we subtract the 320 because this is for the center of our image. And I'm just seeing this is for an image of size 480 times 640, so that doesn't really work here in my case because the camera resolution is too high. Yeah, let's see anyway if it works. So here we get the coordinates based on this display resolution, on this camera resolution. And then it outputs here print virtual world coordinates of the center of the faces, xv, yv, and minus zv. So let's see what it's doing. I'm curious. With this high resolution, Python 3. So I expect it to be scaled. Higher resolution means that the coordinates are scaled accordingly. So the coordinates should become bigger. So let's see. Yeah, so here's my face. Let's see what it outputs. Yeah, here we have the virtual world coordinates. And you can see X, Y, and Z. X, Y, and Z. And this should correspond to a virtual normalized virtual world length of 1 for 1 meter. So when I look at it, it's actually not so far off. So it's kind of okay, it seems. Except that the center is now no longer in the center of the image, but it's on the lower left-hand corner. So that's why we have an off-center position here. And here's the distance from the camera. 30 centimeter. It's actually kind of right, I guess. It's not so bad. So this sort of works. Interesting. Yeah. So this is what you can now use to connect the virtual world with the real world, to mix real and virtual objects. Yeah, so here's an example for this mixing. So we can now take the coordinates from the face detector and put them into the virtual world for an object, for instance, a solid cube or solid sphere or solid teapot with the same width as the head, here 0.16. We move the object to the appropriate position with GL translate. We choose the argument of the projection function glue perspective, field of view equals 25 degrees, to get a similar image as our real camera, right? So I didn't really verify if this is true for my camera. So I just assume that it fits more or less. This results in field of view F, cotangents, field of view divided by 2 is roughly 4.5. So, and then we can execute it with solid cube light translate. So this is our solid cube again, but with the corresponding coordinates. And we should see that the object actually appears with similar size and similar position as the head. So let's try solid cube translate. First gedit. So here you can see our solid cube that we already saw before. Here we have the display perspective projection, where we have the 4.5 field of view. Don't really see it. 25 degrees. Yeah, here's the 25 degrees. Okay, here's the position of the camera, and here we have the glue translate. So this gives us now the corresponding shift in 3D coordinates. So basically we have to take now another glue translate and copy and paste the coordinates here that we just obtained. So let me try that. So here we have those three coordinates. I just copy it, copy and paste. You have to insert a comma, comma, and close the bracket and comment this out here. You can see here we had different coordinates before, depending on where the face is and also what kind of camera I'm using. So here those coordinates are probably a little bit off because of the high resolution of my camera. But let's see. So now I'm executed. Python 3, solid cube translate. Huh, interesting. Yeah, so now the teapot appears down here, lower right, and I guess the size of the head kind of fits. Now just imagine that this, because of the higher resolution of the camera, this image would extend to, to like at least twice as much. And then I guess it roughly would fit. Yeah, and in this way, you can basically translate the position from the camera to the virtual world. Right. So you can now imagine that instead of this teapot, we could now use an avatar and put the avatar at the position of us, of our face in the virtual world. And in this way, we could then have a animated scene in the virtual world using the camera of our head. Yeah. So this is how we could mix the real and virtual world. Okay. Yeah, that should be it for today. Thank you for your attention, and then see you next time.